So these are the basic criticisms right now in August 2011, and it seems as if the government is taking an interest in this. In fact, they have recently announced, the Deputy Prime Minister has announced that the Minister of Defense will be the authority for the Chief of General Staff to be responsible to. But he did not talk about the reorganization of the ministry, which I think should follow naturally in a way. The other problem we have with the military right now, of course, is its constitutional role and its constitutional position. It is, if you analyze, if you examine the constitution, it is not a normal democratic institution as such. It is not under the scrutiny, for instance, of the council of the state, which is a normal procedure for all bureaucracies, state bureaucracies, public bureaucracies, to be brought under the control of. So it's exempted from that. It's a Yüce Divan, the supreme, what do you call it? Yüce Divan is the Supreme Court, the name given to the Supreme Court, supreme, indicating the extraordinariness of the court when the president or the prime minister is accused of crimes, corruption, etc. They're usually tried not in the ordinary courts, but they're tried in this Yüce Divan, the Supreme Court of... The Yüce Divan is actually the Constitutional Court. The Constitutional Court takes an extraordinary position and duty in times when the president and the prime minister is accused of crimes. The former prime minister Mesut Yılmaz, for instance, was tried in Yüce Divan, in the Constitutional Court, and he was acquitted of the charges against him. In the Constitution, the Chief of General Staff is subject to the same procedure. If there is anything, if he does anything wrong, he has to be tried in the Yüce Divan, the Supreme Court. That shows, again, the abnormal situation, the abnormal position of the Chief of General Staff. Of course, everybody talks about Chief of General Staff being, you know, connected with the Prime Minister. This being wrong, we should, you know, the necessity to change it, and the government seems to be doing it. The strategic documents, military strategic documents the military prepares, including the National Security Policy document, they should all be prepared with more civilian input. There is no doubt about it. If we are talking about the method through which it should be prepared, well, it should be prepared through or under the direction of the civilians. I have no doubt about it. Some friends disagree, many military friends disagree, in the sense that, you know, the military should still have a larger or, you know, bigger voice in it. It should have a voice, but not a bigger voice. It should have a voice, but the directions should come from, as I said, from the civilian ministry, as again, where the ministry gains an importance. The objections that are raised against me when I say that is that who knows anything about it? I mean, where is the knowledge basis? There is no knowledge freely circulating around within the civilian sort of departments, ministries, actors. Nobody seems to know, in other words, about Turkey's strategic policies. Even the minister doesn't know. I've been given many incidents. I mean, many people have quoted incidents in which the minister could not utter a word about these questions, you know, strategic questions. There is no really freely circulating objective and satisfactory knowledge about military issues, strategy issues, security issues, or, you know, issues that would be used to sit down and, you know, write a security paper. The threats facing Turkey, what security precautions, what security measures should be taken, how should the war in the Southeast be fought? Very few civilians would be able to answer this question. So even the minister doesn't know. He apparently, you know, when you ask him questions, like he always has his aides, you know, he's always flanked with officers, and every single time he's asked a question, they feed him the information. And in fact, I have never ever seen the former Minister of Defense giving a press conference about, talking freely about the strategies that are followed in the Southeast regarding the terrorism issue there. I don't know if anybody has seen him talk about it for more than 3 minutes, for about 10 minutes, for about 15 minutes, half an hour. What should be the basic priorities? What exactly Turkish military is trying to do in the Southeast? Do we know? I mean, which areas are targeted? Which civilian sectors are considered to be dangerous threats, whatever? What military strategies? No idea. Well, they are being decided by the military commanders, obviously. But the process is obviously incomplete unless we bring the executive actors, bureaucrats, and the parliamentarians in. I'm going to come to the parliament, actually. But let me finish with this, the executive arm, the bureaucracy arm. How can we achieve information sharing, knowledge sharing? How can we have civilians who have the same confidence and same knowledge bases as the officers, and who do not have this feeling of inferiority when they meet the officers, and therefore leave the whole strategy making to them? Well, we gotta start from somewhere. And I insist Ministry of Defense is the best place to start it. How? By letting the minister choose his top advisors, top bureaucrats, starting from the top, going to the middle bureaucracy, and then the junior bureaucrats, and training them, orienting them, exposing them to all these knowledge, and imitate, if necessary, some Western countries. Let's see how ministries are organized, let's say, in France, in England, in Austria. Whatever the Austrians do, what do? In other words, there's room for certain imitation. Change information with NATO, change information with OECD countries. You know, use this network, information network, to completely reorganize and even scratch from bottom up. Recruit intellectuals, those people who have done their PhDs or master's degrees on security issues, etc., etc., etc. We gotta start it. That's all I know. Let's come to the parliament. The defense committee and the budgetary, the key committees in the parliament, should have a large part in Turkey's new thinking, new language, new democratic control over the military. How? In the new constitution, these committees, you do not write about, you do not empower the committees in the constitution, but you refer to the role of the parliaments in making national security policies. That's what the constitution does. So the rest is left to the government, actually. The internal laws and regulations, the internal regulations of the parliament needs to be revised in the sense that Defense Committee is powerless right now. It should be made more powerful. It should be made to look into procurement, big procurements. It should be made to look into what I've been talking about, this national security policy document, threats, and, you know, military strategies. It should hold hearings, as is the case in America. Being able to call commanders who fight in the Southeast, being able to question them about what they are doing, what they intend to do, you know, being able to discuss share information with the military on their own military papers, military strategy papers. I'm not saying that the function of the military should be taken over by the parliament. But what I'm saying is that there should be a new process, a new era for Turkey in which this information first should be made more transparent, because to bring in parliament means that actually the military has to part from some knowledge and information which they consider to be secret. So what I'm suggesting is Turkey's military secrecy should also be democratized to some extent, brought to the parliament, put on the table and be discussed by the members around the table. And what I'm suggesting is also that this empowerment should be done by assigning each member an expert. Actually, in the TESEV constitutional proposal, rather the constitutional report that we, you know, worked on in TESEV, which came out in May, this was one point we emphasized. The parliament, the way to empower Turkish parliament on military issues and defense issues goes through empowering, increasing the capacity of the parliamentarians, the deputies, by assigning them experts on military and defense. That means a new budget, a new reorganization, like I guess in America, in the Congress to some extent, and enable them to do micro analysis, micro scrutiny, not just macro and global scrutiny. This is the way, and this crucially important. I don't know whether it's thought about in Ankara, but I feel sure that some people at least know about the issue, important issue. Formal democratic institution as such. It is now under the scrutiny, for instance, of the Council of the State, which is a normal procedure for all bureaucracies, state bureaucracies, public bureaucracies, to be brought under the control of. So it's exempted from that. It's Yüce Divan, the Supreme Divan, the Supreme Court of... The Yüce Divan is actually the Constitutional Court. The Constitutional Court takes an extraordinary position and duty in times when the president and the prime minister is accused of crimes. The former prime minister Mesut Yılmaz, for instance, was tried in Yüce Divan, in the Constitutional Court, and he was for the chief of general staff to be responsible to. But he did not talk about the reorganization of the ministry, which I think should follow naturally in a way. The other problem we have with the military right now, of course, is its constitutional role and its constitutional position. It is, if you analyze, if you examine the constitution, it is not a So these are the basic criticisms right now in August 2011, and it seems as if the government is taking an interest in this. In fact, they have recently announced, the Deputy Prime Minister has announced that the Ministry of Defense will be the authority for what you call. Yüce Divan is the Supreme Court, the name given to the Supreme Court, Supreme, indicating the extraordinariness of the court when the President or the Prime Minister is accused of crimes, corruption, etc. They are usually tried not in the ordinary courts, but they're tried in this Yüce